Again, my name is Anna Deeny Morales. I'm a librettist as well as a translator of poetry from the Spanish to English, and I teach at the Center for Latin American Studies at Georgetown University here in Washington, D.C. I'll be moderating this conversation with Gen Parton-Shin, Kevin Schroeder, and Sera Finale. We're broadcasting on Crowdcast, and we want you to be part of the conversation. The chat is open for your comments. PEN America staff will also be answering your questions in the chat throughout the event and sharing information about the participants. If you have questions, there's a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen for those questions. This event will be live captioned and translated into German and Japanese. Please see links in the chat for access, and we'll provide periodic visual descriptions for visually impaired members of our audience. Right now, we're in a frame on the left side of the screen. We see branding for PEN America and PEN World Voices in the corners, and there's a chat with lots of comments on the side where people are telling us where they're watching from. So let's get started with the event. Gen Parton-Shin, Kevin Schroeder, and Sera Finale will be discussing their work to translate the hit Broadway musical Hamilton to two distinctly different international contexts, Germany and Japan. Gen Parton-Shin has not only performed in numerous musicals for Japan on Broadway circuit, but also completed official translations like 33 Millimeter, a musical exhibition. For fun, he is currently translating Hamilton to Japanese. Kevin Schroeder, a prolific translator of musicals to German, and Sera Finale, a German rapper and musician, have been working on bringing Hamilton to the German stage. I'll now ask our authors to share their pronouns and a brief visual description of themselves. I use she, her. I'm a light-skinned Latina with long black hair, brown hair, brown eyes and glasses. I'm wearing my black Chicana Park t-shirt with a black blazer, and I have big crimson colored earrings that I got in Puerto Rico. Could we start with Kevin? If you're okay with that, Kevin?
Yeah, sure. Thank you for having me. Yeah, I'm Kevin. I'm a white male. I use he and him. I got dark blonde hair, a little curly, a little bit longer, but not too long. And it's getting a little thinner, I have to say. I got a beard, but also not too long. Maybe it takes about a week to grow. I got green eyes, and I'm wearing a grayish, brownish t-shirt.
Sera, thank you, Kevin. Sera, could you unmute yourself?
Okay, the best start I could get. Hi, my name is Sera Finale. I use he and him. I'm big guy from Berlin, Germany. I have a black t-shirt on. I have headphones on. I have a hat on my head, and that's it. Right? Well, should I say more?
Thank you so much. And Gen.
Hi, I am 6 feet tall. Male. He, him. I got glasses on, short hair, a bit of scruff. I got a piercing on my right ear. I'm wearing like a dark olive green shirt, and feeling good today. How are you?
Thank you so much. So let's go ahead and get to the conversation. So I was thinking about how Hamilton is, among many things, a story about an orphan, a story about displaced and diasporic peoples, and a story about claiming a historical narrative. Alexander Hamilton himself was from a small colonial island called Nevis in the Caribbean. Lin Manuel-Miranda is part of the Puerto Rican diaspora. And in original productions, we have black performers embodying white historical figures. What do you think, if anything, translating to the German and to the Japanese contributes to these series of displacements that are part of the original story and the original libretto and the original performance?
Do you guys want to start, since you guys went through the casting and stuff already, right?
Yeah, we did, but we were not involved in the casting, actually.
Okay.
So that's why I would say by working on the German version of Hamilton, mm-hmm. we didn't pay too much attention to this. We just focused mm-hmm. on the original material, on the textbook and the music, and just trying to tell the story that Lin wrote. Mm-hmm. And I think this is one of the reasons the German stage entertainment wants to produce the show in Germany. I think there are similarities, but mm-hmm. on the other side, I would even say there are much more differences. Mm-hmm. And I think for the German audience, they will have a completely different view on Hamilton than compared to the American audience. So yeah, to be really honest, while working on this, we just focused on Lin's work and mm-hmm. tried to, yeah, as you sometimes say in translations, as free as necessary, as close as possible. So
Could you give an example of that? Of as free as necessary and as close as possible, or what you think this work signifies for German audiences?
Well, I think one approach or one necessary, or let me take one step back. Mm-hmm. I think because the main challenge when translating musical theater pieces, which I've done many different mm-hmm. version styles of, I think the biggest challenge is the form. Because compared to a book or anything, mm-hmm. so many things are said, like the melody, the rhyme pattern, the stresses. Mm-hmm. And of course we can't just throw that aside. We have to, or try at least, to stick to that as well, as close as possible. Mm-hmm. And I think for me, a good translation, at least in terms of musical theater, always depends on a trust you create between the original writer and the translators. And ideally, you got this close, direct relationship, which you sometimes can't have. There's a publisher in between, agents, and this mm-hmm. also sometimes works fine, but best usually is, like, we had the opportunity to meet Lin in person. Mm-hmm. He got to know us, and yeah, I think from the very start, he trusted us. Mm-hmm. And he said right away, well, I want, because the good thing for us was that Lin as well is, how do you say, Duolingo? I mean, he speaks Spanish and mm-hmm. English. Mm-hmm. So he knows the challenges or the differences of another language. So mm-hmm. right, and he also said to us, well, he knows a lot of Spanish translations from mm-hmm. American musicals. And mm-hmm. well, there are some good ones, but sometimes you sit in a show and think, well, it's just a little bit strange Spanish here. That's not, it sounds translated, what we sometimes say. And so he, right from the beginning, said to us, well, he wants that the show sounds well in German. And whatever freedom we need to take, of course, respecting his work, and he can be very, very precise, explaining, no, this is important, we can't compromise on this. But in general, he gave us the freedom to really write an original German show. And I think, yeah, it depends. Each line is different. Sometimes you look at an English line and you can just, even paying attention to melody and everything, it just, your first idea just fits and it's perfect. Mm-hmm. But yeah, not in all cases, of course, obviously, especially not in a show like Hamilton, where I think it's three or four times longer just looking at the text than a regular or, musical theater show. But I think I got lost. What was your question?
No, you answered it. It's when you said that because Lin Manuel Miranda is himself bilingual, just that small fact lends the work itself to translation.
Yeah.
But he is already working in between peoples. And so that's very interesting. How about Gen and Zeta? Would you add to anything that Kevin has said?
So straight off the bat, I just want to make clear that I am not officially translating the show in any capacity. I'm kind of just, the word in Japan, especially on like Twitter sphere, stuff like that, was like, oh, Hamilton's impossible to translate into Japanese. And so a lot of producers were just saying things like, oh yeah, we're not touching that show. Mm-hmm. At which point I was like, oh, let's see if that's true. And so I picked up a pen and turns out it is, I mean, I don't know. I feel like it, with enough time, you know, it's you make anything possible. So back to the kind of race thing, I think that question was not even relevant at that point, because we're thinking, you know, whether it's even possible to translate it or not, and we'll think about the race thing after. Japan's very specific because it's a homogenous country and most people are Japanese, Asian, so already you have ethnic minorities. I would say in terms of applying the color conscious, is it color blind casting, where you know, switch ethnicities for roles? I think there would be a lot of room to play around with casting. For example, I mean, there are like Black people in Japan who've grown up there who are fully fluent in Japanese. You have Blasian kids, you know, half Black, half Asian kids, half white kids, and Japanese kids who are fully fluent in English. There's so much cultural kind of mixed race people in Japan that are specific to the Japanese context that I think kind of just being very flexible with that. I feel like there's potentially a lot of talent there that could make the show come to life and kind of have the same racial diversity that it does in the US, even though it's in Japan. That's my short answer.
How about you, Zera?
Okay, so I was totally hooked from the beginning to translate. When I was asked to, if I could imagine translating a big thing, like a big fish like Hamlet. So the most thing that hooked me was the fact that Berlin is very similar to New York City, for example. So it's a big melting pot, big cultural melting pot, big amount of minorities on a very small area. So this is, we have a big Turkish diaspora, big Arabian, so 25 different cultures living together. So this is, I was born and raised in Berlin, and when I went to school, I faced the minority myself all the time, and with Turkish kids beside me who couldn't even speak German well. So they were born in a city, in a country that they couldn't speak the language. So this was totally great, besides the fact that it's rap. So and especially besides the fact that we said we have no chance to translate it, but we just took the chance. So we did it. So I don't know how we did it, but we did it. So it was a 3 years, right?
That sounds about right. It's 3 years. Yeah. Sounds about right.
To 3 years. So yeah. So but I can relate totally script and the plot and stuff like that. But the most thrilling thing was to translate it not in German language, but to German mindset, because it's a very sensitive thing that you have to reach the heart of the listeners and the audience. So it's not just translating it word by word. Because you have to write between the lines, you have to translate between the lines. So this is the most thrilling thing about it. So and it's the biggest work I ever done. So and like Kevin said, it was great to meet Lin in Manhattan, and I had my iPhone with me, and I had Spotify on it, and we rapped in front of Lin his musical in German, just above his lyrics. So it was. And he flipped the glass and ice cubes went out, and I said, I said, now, okay, that the ice is broken, we can start. So and he was laughing all the time, and he was as nervous as us, because it was the first time that someone tried to translate such a big thing, that you, such a big rock. It's like walking through a rock, what we did. So again, and Kevin will say, yo, to this. So but how to say, it was great. It's a wonderful piece of art, and it's totally huge, and it's like a pyramid.
So let's, how about we go ahead and listen to my shot, and this
okay.
will be the first public presentation.
Yeah.
So Alex, could you, thank you.
Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Bin wie mein Land voll am Starten, bin jung, scharf und geladen. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Ich krieg ein Stipendium fürs King's College. Ich trag mich gern nicht auf, doch schau, ich flash jeden und alles. Ich hab den Grips, doch brauch den letzten Schliff, damit's genial ist. Ich schreie einfach rum wie gestört, damit man mich hört und kick Knowledge. Bin ein roher Diamant, ein Kohlenstück, das blitzt. Hab mein Ziel im Blick, sprach fettig gewitzt. Jedes Wort ist Sitz, grad mal 19, doch mein Geist ist weiter. New Yorker Straßen sind eiskalt und ich schmeiß da alle Bürden, alle tiefen Schläge. Hab gelernt zu leben, hab kein Ballermann zum Wedeln und steh hungrig im Regen. Deswegen werd ich aus Funken Flammen schüren. Yo, merkt euch meinen Namen, lasst sie mich buchstabieren. Ich bin der R-E-X-A-N-D-E-R. Wir vertreten diese Kolonie im Kampf für Autonomie. Denn die Briten, Leute, schnitten uns ja irgendwie. Mann, auf den Knien zeigt ihr ihre Monarchie. Und King George dreht sich um, macht auf Shopping Queen. Er lässt niemals seine Kinder in Freiheit ziehen. Warum sollen wir uns fügen und ihm weiter dienen?
Ich auf ihn.
Anmerkung der Regie. Jetzt betritt A. Hamilton die Szenerie. Ey, ich gäbe mein Leben, wenn Freiheit blieb. Bin der Typ, der in Zukunft Geschichte schrieb. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Bin wie mein Land voll am Starten, bin jung, scharf und geladen. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Bin wie mein Land voll am Starten, bin jung, scharf und geladen. Mann, ich hab nur diesen einen Schuss. Gib mir nur einen Schuss.
Ich will ein Leben ohne Monarchie. Der Aufstand in Frankreich bringt nur Anarchie. Anarchie? Nein, Moment, wie heißt A? Anarchie. Und ich schwöre, dass all die Engländer panisch fliehen bei meinem Schuss.
Ich mach beim Schneider eine Lehre, aber komm nicht klar auf die soziale Schere. Der Aufstand braucht mich, um nicht in die Hose zu gehen. Ich will da ganz nach oben, statt in die Hosen zu nähen. Und feuer meinen Schuss.
Jo, doch was wäre die Freiheit wert, in der man nicht jeden Menschen Ketten für frei erklärt. Frau und Mann, frei und dann, stör mich das Fahren mehr mit dem schwarzen Heer. Stolz und keine Sklaven mehr, gib mir noch einen Schuss.
Gentlemen, senkt eure Stimmen. Mit offenem Visier können wir hier nicht gewinnen. Ich höre euch, doch verliert dabei nicht den Kopf. Die bringen euch für so ein Komplott auf Schafott und da ist dann Schluss.
Bird, zieh mal den Stock. Mr. Lafayette, steinhart wie Lancelot. Ey, deine Hosen sind hot. Lawrence geht ab wie ein Gott. Mann, dieses Squad rockt noch härter als der schwärzeste Block. Ey, ohne Schrott, warum sonst sind wir an diesem Spot? Ich paff die öffentliche Meinung in der Pfeife wie Pott. Ein bunter Haufen schräger, revolutionärer Sklaverei. Gegner, gib mir ein Gewehr und jeder Rotrock frisst Blei später. Oh, rede ich.
Nice! That's badass.
So, you know what's striking to me in your answers is that you really all spoke about the fact that at the heart of this, and Zera, you use the word heart, you know, like at the heart of this is really a deep sense of empathy across these cultures and the fact that all of our cultures have suffered power, right? And that's part of being, that's part of the language being somewhere else. So, but then you also said, Zeta, you said that that work, you alluded to the fact that that work is between the lines. Yeah. So from what we just heard, what could you give one example, if an example comes to mind, of how that is, what is between the lines?
Yeah, between the lines is...
And then Jen, we're going to get to you.
Oh.
don't rest.
Okay, I don't have a straight example. It's just between the lines. You cannot translate wordplay. Mm-hmm. You cannot translate that.
Okay.
You need to translate it emotional, not with intelligence. Mm-hmm. So intelligence you don't need exactly. Yoda would say. But you just need emotional intelligence, uh-huh. EQ. That's it.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
And, you're welcome. And this is why you have to soak in everything between every line. And so I get goosebumps if I talk about it because it's very emotional for us. So it was a very hard up and down road, but if it's gonna play in Germany, oh not. Oh yes. So we talked to Lin again. Oh yeah. So you have to translate it on six layers, simultaneous. So the words, the metrics, the sense, the humor, the and not last but not least, that came last was the choreography. So we totally missed it because you have some words and in the German architecture of words is totally different. So we use so I'm not throwing away my shot. So I'm not throwing away my shot. So in Germany, so all we could say was I have only this one shot. So you cannot translate it so that the choreography is totally on the words. So we have to do it again. So the thing I realized is, and Kevin as well, it's working similar on 6-5-6 layers. So this is the main problem. And so you have to soak everything in. You have to understand this. You have to understand it emotionally, and then you can start translating. So even in this very huge amount of respect to Lin and to everybody involved in the original thing, so we didn't want to f it up. So that's why it's very, very big respect to you guys over there. So and this is between the lines for me, that you and then again to reach people in Germany who are not totally not involved in American history. So you cannot reach them emotionally by saying who was watching this and that, and then he went there. So we have German history, but we are fed up with German history because so in school we only had Third Reich, so that's it. So you couldn't make music about that. I'm sorry, it was a sure shot to make to amerikanische Gründungsväter. And the parents of American history. So it was very clever, very smart from Lin to do this. So it's very deep in the hearts of American citizens. And you have to translate that as well. So you have to count on jokes that only Germans will understand, wordplays and stuff like that. So it's a very, very big chemical laboratory that we worked in for 3 years.
Kevin, what about you?
Yeah, I'm always, I think what's in between the lines is Sera talked about the layers. And I think first, yeah, you start with a feeling, I'd say. Yeah, you start to feel what, of course, the general feeling or emotion of the show, but then you look at each song and you don't start with the details, you start with the basic feeling of it. And this is, I think this is what Sera was talking about, this happens subconsciously. You just listen to the music, and I think for musical theater, it starts with the music, and so the music is just subconsciously giving you things. And I think for my shot, it's this urge. I mean, he doesn't even know where he wants to go, but he has this urge just to get out of the situation he's in, and he wants to go somewhere, maybe not even knowing. We talked with Andy Blankenbuehler about the choreography. And he said a lot of the choreography is about just rage and anger going, wanting to express yourself, going somewhere. But it's not, they don't really have the clear idea yet what they want. Mm-hmm. It just needs to change. And I want to go somewhere, but I can't express it. So, and this, I think this is what's in between the lines, and where we then try to come up with German phrases, idioms, anything that can transport this feeling. And of course, then you go layer by layer and you get, polish the details. And ideally, I mean, I think for translation, if you have like 10 check boxes, if you check all of them, then it would be the original in German. But to be honest, most of the time, it's already great if you check 8 or 9. And there's always one area where you maybe need a little compromise, depending on the department. And then what I said earlier, if you have a great team, like we are now experiencing with Hamilton, who are open to each other, well, we listen to each other. It's a lot about communication, I think. Mm-hmm. Musical theater in general, it's all comes down to communication. And then you can see, well, you listen to each other, how you see it, what's the American view on it, and then we tell them what's the German view on it, which is, again, if the German audience sees Hamilton, they will pay attention to completely different things. I think I mean, I can't really tell, and I can't even tell if it will be a success in Germany, because there nobody knows. But
it's gonna be a success.
Yeah, hopefully. but I think it's a lot. It's in some sense, I think the German audience will look at the show like they look at America, if I may say so. I mean, this Germany has a very particular relationship with the USA after the Second World War, and also like with pop and hip hop music. I mean, a lot of the culture, at least the music culture, for I think now for maybe 20 years, there's German pop music, or maybe a little longer now, but I think for the first 30, 40 years, we all just listen to English songs. So, but also like I once said that, and I don't know who it was from the team, but I think in some sense, Alexander Hamilton is, if we look at Alexander Hamilton as Germans, I think in some sense, it's like looking at America, like going forward, sometimes doing things, at least the stereotypical German, at least I'd say, wouldn't dare to do, or just the bravado, which with you sometimes also the like entrepreneurship and everything that we associate with America, which we sometimes maybe, well, let's think about it again and structure it and make a plan. And Alexander Hamilton is just go forward and do it. Mm-hmm. And these are some points where I think the German audience will just look at it and be amazed by some sense, sometimes the big brother.
How about we pivot now to Gen's translation in the song Helpless? Could you go ahead and talk about the translation?
Oh,
Helpless.
Or maybe you could just rap the Hamilton part.
Oh, sure. イライザぶっちゃけお金はない地位もない期待はしないでいただきたいあるのは名誉我慢強さと大学の単位とこの図のおう本当君の家族に救われたペギーは味方アジェリカには食らいつかれた大丈夫俺の愛はマシグラハーレムで始めよう二人暮らし子供の時からずっと一人だったててなしママは私別ワイルドなまま育った母の顔は胸の中俺がいる限り悲しませはしないさ We should have done that from the beginning.
How do we bring together, because really we're hearing this, I don't speak Japanese, so I apologize for that, but what I'm hearing is form and feeling and rhythm.
Yeah. So try to honor the original rhythm as much as possible. And then just even like the nuances, like he's flirting with her. So a lot of the words that I chose were very much like direct kind of confident language that he's using towards him.
Could you give an example of that?
There are different ways to say me in Japanese. You can say boku, ore. Boku is a little more humble. Ore is a little more cocky. Mm-hmm. With Hamilton, pretty much throughout the show, I use ore. It just kind of, and there's just like suffixes that you can add to the end of the language that makes a phrase more masculine, more feminine. And then you can play around with that. You can like, you know, give male characters feminine, you know, tones. And like, it'll just like, you can play so much with the nuances that you actually cannot in English, which are tools that I can use for my Japanese translations that will help me adapt the kind of feel of the English one into Japanese. But like, using tools that only exist in Japanese.
So throughout your translation, if or as you know, depending on how far along you've gotten it, have you to give an arch or a nuance to Hamilton as a character or any of the other characters? Have you varied with regard to a range of gender? A more humble or a more aggressive?
With gender, he's pretty much a cocky dude throughout. He's pretty masculine throughout, I would say. The girls are definitely pretty girly. King George, I put him pretty feminine. It just kind of adds to the, I mean, it's just, I mean, you know, he's played, but like they say, it's very much mm-hmm. presentational, and it's kind of like, oh yes, me, moi, of course. So I try to, I definitely play around with King George with the feminine and the masculine. Wait, isn't that something that exists in German too, though?
No, I mean, not in the language that you can just, it's just a matter of attitude.
The words. It's,
you don't have different words for, yeah. I mean, German is much more similar to English. I mean, that's a plus for us. Sometimes right. you get lucky, like helpless, yeah. you can do in German, hilflos.
Yeah.
Which is, it has the same root, but I mean, Japanese is just a completely different level, I'd say.
Yeah, so the challenge is Japanese fits less information than it does in English when you have the same number of notes. I would say Japanese can fit about 70%. And so in order to make it work, you really have to reinterpret, which is kind of what Sera was saying earlier, but you really have to reinterpret phrases and like any opportunity I can pull like a Japanese idiom. So basically the more information is condensed, the less space it takes up. And things like idioms are really good because they pack a meaning into it. And not only that, because they come so naturally to Japanese people that when they hear it, the meaning kind of just drops in to the listener without the listener having to kind of like I feel like when the listener is like trying so hard to follow what's being said, then you're going to start losing them. Whereas if you can create the lines in a way that it kind of just falls into the listener's body, it's such a better listening experience. So much then you can enjoy the rhythm and the and then of course, you know, the staging and the choreography and all that. So, and I feel like that happens with English. A lot of what I do is actually choosing what I have to let go of, because oftentimes you just simply can't fit everything in there. but in those situations, instead of prioritizing the meaning, I would prioritize the emotional message that's being, you know, conveyed in a certain line, which is also ties back to what Sera and Kevin were saying. It's like mm-hmm. the emotional element, what's being said in order to push the story forward. It's not necessarily the detailed, like mm-hmm. specific translation that needs to be there. It's the emotion that needs to be conveyed.
Mm-hmm. So we've got a first question here from Arika. Arika says, I noticed the anarchy line in the translation, but couldn't otherwise tell. Does Lafayette sing a French accent in German?
Naturellement, mademoiselle. Yeah, he does. Or Kevin?
Yeah. Throughout the whole show, yeah.
Okay.
That was fun as well, and we used that as for example, the rhymes sometimes just rhyme because it's a French accent. They wouldn't rhyme if it would be correct German for him as well.
Yeah.
And then, what were you going to say?
I have a question to Gen.
Go for it.
Yes.
Okay, so this is the main part of our translation that we're talking about the whole time, the rap quotes.
The
rap quotes on it.
The rap quotes, what is that?
Yeah. There are maybe 10 quotes from famous rap songs in the Hamilton
piece. Oh yeah
from Biggie and mm-hmm. Mobb Deep and several rap artists. So and we even to make it perfect for our feeling, we didn't translate it, but we put German rap quotes in it.
For the
German audience to, because they will feel it more and they will remind of German rap songs. And this is the only small piece, homeopathic piece of German rap culture that comes into this translation, and they will feel familiar with this and comfortable if you uh-huh. have German. And then my question was, did you that as well for Japanese rap songs, and how's Japanese rap community, and do you have big rap scene over there?
Uh-huh. I have not done that, but that's a great idea, and I think I'm going to look into it.
Yeah.
What I did focus on was the motifs, of course, because those are recurring. And there is a pretty big Japanese rap scene. I would say rap is definitely counterculture. It's not mainstream, and it's only like becoming mainstream recently. Japan is such a kind of proper culture, and it's very presentational. And so something like rap that is like directly kind of, I would say anarchical, but you know, anti-establishment, it how would you call it mainstream? I don't think it would ever be mainstream. Yeah. And I think that's the beauty of it.
Okay, great.
Yeah. What are some
can I follow up on that question?
Yeah.
Do you think that that's part of why you wanted to translate this work?
Oh, I was. I'm just a big.
People say, "Oh, you can't do that."
I'm just a big fat nerd. I had a concert in Japan, my solo show, and I wanted to try this. And so I translated my shot and I performed it, and it came out so well and it sounded so great and I got amazing feedback. And so I continued translating show. I've done most of the show now, but for me, honestly, though, this work has informed my actual legitimate work or my official translation work. I'm on my third show now. But like just the hours tackling Hamilton have helped me with the other work so much that all of it just ties in. I don't consider any of it a waste of time at all. And, you know, and if they ever do do Hamilton in Japan, then I could be like, hey, I got something. So, you know, see if you want to use it. I know there's like one other guy who's translating it on his own, but we'll see what happens.
I always feel when people say something is impossible to translate, I think, well, it's impossible to say things in the first place. I mean, you tell someone I love you and, you know, what happens to that? It's like, okay, so love is impossible, but we do it every single day, freely and against everything, right? So I feel the same way.
And I think it really, people look at it the wrong way. They see Alexander Hamilton or Hamilton and they go, oh, it's American history. You know, the Japanese people aren't going to understand it. They don't get the context behind it. You know, they're not as educated about American politicians and all this stuff. But Hamilton is such an emotional story. It's every human emotion. It covers so broadly that I feel like that's why Hamilton is successful. And people, once they see it, I think they'll get it. I truly do.
To that point, there's another question that came in for all of you. Working on a translation of such a well-known show and global phenomenon, the person who asked says, into German and Japanese, did you feel any pressure during your time working on it? Or do you now after the production has been announced? So,
no, we got no. We,
social media and stuff. It says
the good. Okay, Kevin, just
yeah. I can go ahead. Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Not really. I mean, sometimes, of course, you got these moments where you are frustrated, or maybe when you start a song, think how this could ever work. But not. I mean, I'm not thinking, and I guess it's the same for Sera. We were not thinking about success or anything of like that. It was just most of the time was just fun. I mean, it's a challenge. It's like trying to solve riddles in a way. I mean, just you sit there, just be patient, have fun, try to be creative, try to, if one approach doesn't work, maybe take a walk, and then next day you just have it. And I mean, no, I never felt stressed. It was just, yeah, fun.
It's just, for me, I come from a rap background, and I used to battle rap on stage.
Oh, wow.
So you don't have a second chance to make a first impression, and you stay up there. So Hamilton is the first musical that I translated with Kevin together.
What was the process between you two? How did you collaborate?
Great. Well,
we just sit together and jamming and rhyming, and we had a great time together. So Kevin is right now, he's a very, very good battle rapper as well.
Let's hear it.
So if you are scared, you will never have the chance to translate it to finish it. So anxiety is just a side role in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
because you cannot do it if you're scared. So, but yeah, we don't know what will happen, you know. And but Hamilton is so much for me. Hamilton is so much bigger and stands for every minority all around this planet. So it's not American history, Afro American. So this is why it's glued to that culture, to your culture. But for me, it's just a mouthpiece, a megaphone for every minority around this planet. Because you can achieve anything in this world if you just want to achieve it. Even a Hamilton translation, you can do it as well. So this is that's the main point. And so Lin is a genius, obviously, mm-hmm. doing this, seeing this. So you have to see something. You can have a great idea, but if you don't put it to reality, then it's just a great idea. It's worthless. So you have to do it. And he took 7 years to write it. And sometimes I had the feeling that we need more time to translate it, because this is like a big Baustelle. Kevin, was Baustelle?
Buildings, construction site.
Because you have to fix everything like there, and you put it together, and it's breaking down like in pieces, and you have to build it up again. So it's very, it's dancing around the words sometimes. So I don't know, but I see the outlines. Even if again, I listen to your translation to Japanese, and I can hear the emotions between the lines as well, because okay, I know the metrics and stuff like that, but the outlines are totally the same. The color is different, so we are painting the colors with our cultural background tubes, which so we have different colors. So for example, just to put it straight down, we have black, red and gold colors, and Gen has white and red color, so but the picture looks a little different, so uh-huh. everybody wants to see it uh-huh. from Japanese and from Germany. So, mm-hmm.
Could you all, to your point, could you all speak a little bit more specifically about how your experiences inform the specificity of your translations?
Oh, whew, this is it's half to 1 year in the past. So okay, Kevin, maybe you can help me out. he's the master.
Sera, you spoke about growing up in Berlin, being from a Turkish family. Is that what you had mentioned?
No. But I have most of my friends have a minority background, and mm-hmm. so I can. For me, everybody could be Hamilton in Berlin. So growing up, so we just talked about, Kevin and I talked about the caste in Germany can also be Turkish, mm-hmm. can also be Arabic, and mm-hmm. so whatever. So everything, Chinese, Japanese, so it doesn't matter. It's just a minority standing up, rising up, speaking loud. This is only has one shot to chase their dreams. This is it. This is for me. This is the piece. Like, mm-hmm. if you see Lin with a Hispanic background in Harlem, it's the same like Kreuzberg in Berlin. It's mm-hmm. exactly the same. It's no difference.
Yeah,
and Kevin and Gen.
Well, I mean, I my mother's third generation Korean, born and raised in Japan, and this is the historical background. Korea used to be colonized by Japan, so a lot of Korean immigrants migrated to Japan, and of course there's a lot of discrimination and all that, and then but then I'm also half British, so I'm a mix of colonizer and colonized. And then, you know, I came to the United States as an immigrant, and now I live here, so always an outsider, but always kind of like a fighter survivor. I don't, you know, it's just who I am, so I don't really think much of it at this point, but I do look around and I see that I am probably different from a lot of people who are, you know, grow up slightly more, you know, in one location or whatever. I have had to fight to be here. I mean, but you know, such is life. I've kind of just accepted that is life. But you know, absolutely, I resonate with Hamilton. I think it's absolutely fantastic. There should be more shows like this. It takes a kind of a drive, I think, to write something like this, to spend 7 years, because it's like you have something to prove, you know, you have a message to deliver, and it's very powerful when it comes from a place of your reality, I think. I think adversity is good for people. I honestly, like, I reject comfort. Comfort is great, but I think comfort also kills you. It makes you mediocre. So I'm thankful for the adversity that I've had in life, and we just keep moving forward, right? keep pushing the realm of possibility and what is possible.
And Kevin?
Yeah, I think I'm always trying, or I'm approaching my translations from an actor's point of view. So first of all, I'm trying to be Lin in the first place. And then at the second look, I try to be every character in that show. And I think, I'm sure a lot of things happen on a subconscious level, sure. But I really just, what I said in the beginning, I really just look at the material and try to see just humans in a play. And I think the one thing that was an extra for me, because this is, I mean, obviously there hasn't been a German hip hop musical yet, not really. I mean, the musical style of the musicals that are being produced here in Germany is it doesn't have that variety like in New York, but there's a certain variety. But my personal background, or my personal taste as well, when I grew up, it's much more influenced by 80s and 90s hip hop music, may it be American, but also German, which started out at, I'd say, late 80s, early 90s. So I just was happy to have that opportunity to finally write something which is dear to my heart, just, and which I kind of lost, like working in musical theater in Germany for the last 20 years. And I kind of lost that connection to hip hop music. And so Hamilton gave me the opportunity to reconnect with that. So this was just a very personal thing for me, yeah.
Do you feel that, and this is for all of you, do you feel that hip hop music and rap has exchanged, or has expanded the flexibility of your languages, of local languages?
Yeah, you mean for our translation of Hamilton?
Yeah, but also just in general.
Yeah, I mean, I hope it will be another color that will be added to, and not just because now Hamilton was a huge success and producers think, well, hip-hop musicals are the new thing and we just do that. Mm-hmm. No, but it's just, I mean, if you look at classical musical theater heroes, mm-hmm. I'd say, like Stephen Sondheim, you could argue there are songs of him which are close to rap already in the 70s. Mm-hmm. So it's... But I think also, I mean, I'm just not a translator. I also work as a lyricist and book writer for my own shows. Mm-hmm. And I'm always looking to go into different areas, because I don't know about the US, but in Germany at least, there's most cases, there's a clear separation between like pop writers and theater writers or classical mm-hmm. composers. There are always kind of some prejudices hanging around, and people need to be convinced to collaborate and try something new. And I have been trying to do that, trying to be creative and just tell your own story. I mean, who tells your story? And you just can, I mean, especially of course, when I'm writing my own stuff, you have to tell something and you can only tell about yourself. So, mm-hmm. but when I collaborate with also for the translation with somebody like Sera, we are influencing each other, and I'm taking something from him, giving him something back. So this is something new created. Yeah.
It's interesting. In my translations, I try hard to represent all of the languages that English breathes, swallows, chews, spits out, gargles, everything. Do you know? So when people talk about like the, you know, this is going to the English, I think, well, it's not just one English. There are these multiple languages and sounds crossing through the language. And so I'm very interested in how, like the flexibility of those forms, right? And even how the flexibility, like you said before, Kevin, you're focusing on form, right? That intersection of the meaning and the form, the musical form. So, yeah, what about you, Zera, again?
I'm just focusing on feelings. Mm-hmm. this is my profession. I'm writing songs in German, mm-hmm. and sometimes famous songs, sometimes not famous. But my my approach is only to be part of it. Why the genesis starts, mm-hmm. to be in the studio and to grab into the infinity, grab something, listen to it, and put it on paper. And if it lasts on paper, then it's a good idea. If not, then it flies away, and it's not mine. It's not my words. Mm-hmm. I'm just a was ist Hebamme? I'm sorry. I'm just a nurse getting babies on.
A midwife.
So I'm a midwife. Mm-hmm. Just to make it clear, for me, it's all about feelings. Maybe the audience is not the smartest, like us, like translating a piece like that, but it's very smart and emotional things. Like if it and it recognizes totally fast if something is real or not. Well, this is what it's all about for me. Mm-hmm. The feeling must be real. So the language it's secondary. So it's not very important. If you can transform feelings into that language, then it's fine. If not, then go ahead and do something else. So you need the feelings.
I agree with you. I think though that just speaking in my own personal experience, my mom is Puerto Rican and I grew up here in the mainland US. And when you grow up with multiple languages and cultures, that multiplicity embedded in that is hurt because people move from one place to another, not because of felicitous reasons, they move for unhappy reasons. And so embedded in that multiplicity of those languages is the suffering of those who came before you. Do you see what I'm saying? So that for me is at the heart of much of the translation
that
I do. And I think that thinking through how language can be flexible expands the possibility of the expression of those feelings.
Yeah, of course. Totally agree.
I don't mean to take it to thinking about these words. It's really so it's interesting talking about Hamilton, that's those feelings of being far away, of not being in home. Either through decision or through forced reasons, I think is at the heart of a lot of this work.
Yeah, but in general, I totally agree. Mm-hmm. But you have different languages and you can talk to someone maybe about how it feels to get burned. And one had its hand in fire, in flames, mm-hmm. and the other just had it in 60 degrees warm water. And it felt, oh, I got burned in water. So you will never get to one point that you have the same feeling, saying I got burned. Mm-hmm. So this is why the setting in different languages is different. Mm-hmm. So when I went to San Francisco back in the days, I used to rap and with Freestyle Fellowship, some Bay Area rap artists, mm-hmm. big rap crew over there, and I started to thinking in English after I've been there for 1 week, and the thoughts were totally different thoughts, another language. I don't know if you saw the movie Arrival, that aliens mm-hmm. come down and so in the language is. For just forms and things, it has another dimension. Mm-hmm. So in every language has its own dimensions, mm-hmm. its own area and its own feelings. So, and I know Lin. I think Lin is satisfied with our translation because, and even he said, "Oh, they got another word for burr. We had another rhyme on burr that he didn't get." So, and he was a little jealous.
What's the rhyme?
Saboteur.
Saboteur burr. So saboteur is French for sabotage, saboteur. So said, oh shit, they found saboteur and I didn't found it. So that was very funny for us. So and I know he's totally in it because it's his soul and we are carrying his soul to another language. So we're very, very respectful.
I struggled with burr, sir, because san, I don't know if you know, san is the suffix you put after a name, which kind of signifies an honorary way to say it. So mm-hmm. like you'd be Anna-san or, you know, Sera-san, Kevin-san. But then ba, burr is ba. Ba-san means grandmother. Mm-hmm. So first guy, everyone's coming in. Oh, are you Ba-san, grandmother? I said, this doesn't work. It just doesn't work. And so instead of Ba-san, I switched the sir into, I split it into two versions. So desu-ka and desu-ga. Desu-ka is, are you Mr. Burr? And desu-ga is, I am Burr, however. And so it connects to the next sentence. And so depending on the context, Burr sir has turned into desu-ka, ba desu-ka, or ba desu-ga. I just thought of that just because you said Burr sir.
So on that note,
yeah.
Thank you so much. Wrapping up with Burr, sir, Zabater, and soul that's carried across the globe. I thank you so much. Great to meet you. Wonderful conversation. I can't wait to see your shows. And we thank you all for joining us. The Penn World Voices Festival isn't over. So visit penn.org/festival to hear more from your favorite authors, and have a great evening to you all. Great to meet you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Anna.
Muchas gracias. Adios.
Un abrazo para todos.
Arigato gozaimasu. Mata ne.
Arigato.
Bye-bye.